A new study reveals an overwhelming majority of European nations limit elective abortions prior to 15 weeks gestation. This comes as the Supreme Court prepares to take up Mississippi's abortion law this fall, which limits abortion at 15 weeks. The new comprehensive analysis from the Charlotte Lozier Institute finds that 47 out of 50 European nations limit elective abortion prior to 15 weeks. 0 out of 50 U.S. states have currently enforceable limits on abortion at 15 weeks. The study also finds that no European nations allow elective abortion through all 9 months of pregnancy, which is currently permitted in several U.S. states. The U.S. Supreme Court this fall will hear oral arguments in Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health Organization over the constitutionality on abortion prior to a child's viability. The case was prompted by a pro-life Mississippi law which protects the life of an unborn child starting at 15 weeks gestation. Joining us now is Chuck Donovan, president of the Charlotte Lozier Institute, and the recently engaged Mallory Quigley, vice president of communications for the Susan B. Anthony List. It is great to welcome you both here. Chuck, I want to start with you. Break this down for us. What were the main findings of this recent Charlotte Lozier Institute report?
Well, Catherine, we compared the United States, which has 50 states, of course, and 50 different laws, but we also have Roe v. Wade, which pretty much allows elective abortion up until birth. And European nations have not followed that course, generally speaking. We looked at 50 countries, a minimum of 1 million population, and the conclusion is pretty stark. 47 of the 50 would be classified as more conservative, more protective of the unborn than the United States, and certainly Mississippi. Even Mississippi's 15-week limit would be fairly liberal in New York. In Europe.
Right. It really does reveal that Mississippi's abortion ban at 15 weeks is more in line with European and global norms. Chuck, what is your goal in releasing this ahead of the Supreme Court hearing on Mississippi's law? Is it ultimately to influence the justices? What's your hope here?
Well, we like the justices who sometimes, at least the liberal members of the court, like to hail European law as being more advanced than the United States and just be square with it on human rights questions. But when it comes to the human rights of the unborn, we're radical. We're the radical country, and we'd like them at least to have a sense that by moving the limit back, we'd like to see, of course, Roe v. Wade be reversed, but by moving it back, the court would be doing a very mainstream thing by international standards.
And that goes against all the abortion industry's messaging on this, of course. Mallory, 79 pro-life women and state legislators joined the Susan B. Anthony List on an amicus brief filed last week, urging the Supreme Court to uphold Mississippi's 15-week abortion limit. Can you explain what is an amicus brief exactly, and what is your group's message to the High Court?
Yes, so an amicus brief means friend of the court brief. These are, anyone can submit one if you have an interest in the case at hand. And so our amicus brief, which was signed on to by those pro-life women legislators you mentioned, explains the history of women's representation across state legislative bodies and in the federal legislature. When the Supreme Court decided Roe versus Wade in 1973, it was seven unelected men who made that decision and instigated abortion on demand for the entire nation. Since then, women have a much larger representation in state legislatures, as elected representatives in the federal legislature. So, and there's women on both sides of this issue. So our message to the court is, this is an issue that belongs in the legislative branch of government. Let lawmakers in, you know, civil discourse, in the process established by the founders, pass laws that represent the people that live in the states, and stop being so paternalistic.
That makes sense. I mean, so much has changed since the Roe v. Wade decision in 1973. And Chuck, I understand the Charlotte Lozier Institute also submitted an amicus brief. What was your message to the court?
Well, we're focused on science and statistics for life. And you're right, things have changed dramatically. What we focus on with the court is the advances in science, in perinatal medicine, in protecting the child in the womb, being able to do testing, to do fetal surgery, to treat twin syndrome, even at the 15-week mark, which is what Mississippi holds as protection. And we had some incredible testimony from Maureen Kondik, an expert in neonatology, embryology, about the beginning of life. There's just no question the science supports that this is a living human being in the womb who can be a patient, be cured, and be cared for.
Absolutely. I mean, look how much ultrasound technology has advanced since Roe v. Wade.
It hardly existed in the early 1970s, and it certainly wasn't standard care. Now virtually everyone in the United States, you'll see it in advertising, you'll see it on your refrigerator. Mm-hmm. It's the first picture in the baby album. That's new. The court didn't have that kind of sensitivity to the unborn 50 years ago.
Absolutely. Mallory, from your perspective, how much is riding on this Supreme Court abortion case? What should the pro-life movement's expectations be? Put this into perspective for us.
Sure. Well, and I'd be curious about Chuck's opinion on this, but I don't think that it's out of line to say that this is the most significant abortion case that the court has taken up since Planned Parenthood versus Casey in 1992. This is going to be, we've had other major abortion cases in recent years, but this is the first time the court is going to be addressing that line, which is currently non-existent, of where we might limit abortion. You know, we've talked about the health and safety standards for abortion facilities. We've talked about, you know, taxpayer funding of abortion. But this case is about, okay, at a certain point, we're going to say no to abortion. Previous cases on, for example, the partial birth abortion ban, that was about a procedure, not about a point in time where we're going to protect life. So the court could move on a variety of ways. They could uphold Mississippi's law. They could do that without overturning Roe versus Wade. Of mm-hmm. course, the Mississippi Attorney General, Lynn Finch, has outright asked the court to change its jurisprudence and to undo the damage that's been done, the lives that have been lost in the ensuing years since Roe. So it's very important. We need everyone watching to pray yeah. that the justices will do the right thing.
Absolutely. Well, just to follow up on that, Chuck, what do you think? Put this Supreme Court case into perspective for us. You've been a champion of the pro-life movement for years.
Well, I think it's the most significant case we've had actually since Roe itself. We've walked up to this point where the court now is willing to consider and voted to consider a case that involves actual limits that protect the baby. We're not talking about a technique of abortion. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about health standards. We're not talking about parental notice, important as those things are. Mm-hmm. Mississippi's law says we are going to protect this baby. The baby cannot be killed. And that question opened up by the Supreme Court really takes the whole territory before viability and says, what can the states do? And we're hopeful the court will mm-hmm. say they can protect the unborn from conception.
It's great to hear that there is that hopefulness there. Mallory, the Supreme Court hearing is in the fall. Decision may come as late as June 2022, which is just months before midterms. Are you taking this Supreme Court case into account with your political strategy?
Absolutely. And I think the most important thing here is that many Americans, even pro-life Americans, even Supreme Court justices, perhaps don't realize that the United States has abortion on demand up until the moment of birth, that we're one of seven countries that allows abortion on demand beyond the point the baby can feel pain. We stand with China and North Korea in this regard. And so this being a major opportunity to have a national conversation about abortion policy and where different candidates stand on this question is, I think, going to be very helpful going into the campaign season to draw people's opinions out on this, to educate Americans, and hopefully lead them to vote pro-life with those legislators then enacting pro-life laws.
It'll be interesting to see how that all plays out. And Chuck, I need to ask you about this. Last week, the House of Representatives passed spending bills without the Hyde Amendment. Every House Democrat voted against Hyde. You've done a lot of research into the Hyde Amendment and how it's saved so many lives. What's your reaction to this?
Well, it's an historic mistake if it happens. We still have considerable hope that the Senate, 50-50 split though it is, it may be able to resist this. It would be an historic change. It would increase the number of abortions. It would have disparate impact on minority babies in the United States who have a disproportionate number of abortions. But more importantly, it would put the United States government on the side of promoting an anti-life philosophy. So we've resisted it mightily. I'm personally optimistic that at the last moment, if we stick to our high principles, we'll be able to prevent this
And Senator
terrible Manchin, legislation.
Absolutely. Senator Manchin has voiced his support for Hyde. So there is that hope there as well. Mallory Quigley and Chuck Donovan, thank you so much for coming here and for your expert analysis.
Our pleasure.
Thank you.